dot is wrong.
Now it's a square dot?
Yes.
And it's recording?
Yes.
Okay, my name is Tim Darmark, and this is Georgina Speaks. It's another podcast, and what we're doing this morning is we're going to broach preliminarily the subjects that we're going to talk to surrounding our main issue today. And we're lucky to have with us today Martin Ash, who's been in Georgina for 63 years.
Yes.
Yeah, well, that's... So,
hate to admit it, but
based,
I am.
Considering based on the Sodoras and the Winches and the Peters, he's a relative newcomer. But based on my only being here 45 years, something like that, he's an old timer. So Martin, why don't you broach the subject that we're going to introduce the subject that we're going to be talking to today, based on our main theme of wasted tax dollars.
Well, yes, we've been looking at lakefront ownership in Georgina, and the town has been spending money on consulting and legal fees, and the homeowners are kind of up in arms about it. And what we're talking about here is property rights, and it's very important in Canada. Our freedom and everything that we have here in our democracy is a lot based on our property rights, and it's a very important issue. And I believe that it ends up being a political issue, and not so big of a legal issue. So we're going to talk a bit more about that, and how we might move forward on some of this stuff.
Okay, so thank you for that. So what we're talking about is all of the indirect lakefronts that run all the way from Church Street, pretty much all the way up to Jackson's Point. It has been the subject of a number of legal opinions over the years. The majority of them based on an original opinion done by a guy by the name of Rusty Russell. And he was considered to be one of the foremost authorities on this type of an issue. So I guess the best thing to talk, a good way to start, I'll introduce what makes it a big issue right away. We have enough documentation going back about 70 years that says two or three things. Let me get my little book here and I'll give you the list just to get us rolling. There's two things that we've established that we've known for at least 35, 40 years that the town's made several attempts in recent years. And what was established in a 1992, for example, there was a 1992 meeting. And what was established at that time and before and any legal opinion since has clearly established that it's not possible to know who actually owns those pieces of land. That's one thing we know for sure. I don't know if that's your take on it.
Well, yes, I've read the legal opinions, and they are opinions, of course, yeah. And it's really pretty wishy-washy about who owns these things in it. And I think the town and the people would like to have this resolved somehow,
right,
so that they know where they stand on this.
Right.
I've been a realtor in the area since 1975, and whenever we sell properties in those areas, we got to be very, very careful and instruct our people that, well, you may or may not own this, and if you do, you have some rights, but not all. You know, and it's just it's so difficult to sell something. Because we really don't know, but at least we inform the people about what we do know.
Okay, so the one thing we know, it's not possible to know who owns it.
Yeah.
Everybody's in agreement. There's actually no real possible way to know who owns it. Number two, there's actually only two people that could own it.
Right.
That's the town or the people that are linked to the property across the road.
Exactly.
Yeah. Right, so that's adjacent to the property across the road. So that's the only two people could possibly own it. And I believe the consensus, it's not stated specifically, but it's stated in all of the opinions that, and all of the proposed solutions, the only resolution of title on those properties is going to be by agreement of both parties.
Of course.
So then there's not going to be any legal, there's not going to be any established precedent of legal. There's not going to be a legal decision that this person actually owns it. It's going to be an agreement of both parties that's going to resolve it or not.
As I said, it's a political issue, really not a legal issue, because the legal has already been established that they don't know.
Yeah.
And so then
it's not possible to know.
Yeah, okay. And so then the town will have to intervene and try to clear it up.
And so, and to carry that on further, the thing that's been confirmed and reaffirmed and reestablished ever since is that the owner's rights are acknowledged by the town, And I want the distinction that they're acknowledged by the town. They're not granted by the town.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So that's their rights.
Yes.
And those rights have been acknowledged by the town, both in policies, in the town's behavior, and in the town's decisions, and their regulations and their bylaws. Over the years, the town's actually established their rights solidly in law, I believe. So there's that aspect of it. So I guess I don't want to get too hard into the weeds today because there's not. But the point in all of it is, I believe both that information that we just discussed in terms of ownership and who can and who can't, and the fact that everybody has to agree, has been established since at least 92. Since what happened was in 92, the town was starting to look at the issue, and a guy I happen to know, his name is Charles Loopstra.
Yes.
I went up against him more than one. I actually went up against him in the development charges here, and I won. And that's kind of related to another part of this issue, because the two people that were running that whole thing was Rebecca Mathis and then Winann Grant.
Yeah.
It cost the town $500,000 to lose. Loopster guaranteed a win, and he did win. He got $500,000.
Yeah.
So, and the point of it is that those same two people who rely on legal opinions and consultants for everything are the people who train the current council.
Right.
So would you think that those two people, based on the way that they behave on this issue, on that issue that I was involved in, do you think they trained the town to give direction to council or to staff or to get direction from staff?
Well, yeah, that's a good question, I would
right.
think.
Yeah. Okay, so, I'm not going to go into it any further because I'll get pretty catty.
Yeah, yeah.
But I happen to believe that. I believe that this council was not trained properly and left. And there's some other contributory things to that, and that has to do with the way that the budgets in Georgina have evolved through the transition from old school to new school, the old computer system to the new system. It's running pretty good up there now, I got to say that. Rebecca Matheson actually was responsible for that transition, and she took on an awful lot, which might explain some of the anomalies. So, I mean, I don't want to be unkind. So the Loopster's 92 opinion that he provided to the town, it addressed the Russell report, and then in the most recent one, this effort, I believe, was brought forward primarily by Winann Grant, who's no longer with us. Don't want to go into that either, but It's another lawyer. It's a lawyer by the name of Biggert, or Richie Ketchison Hart and Biggert is the law firm, and their opinion. You read this stuff that I sent you, yeah. And it primarily agrees with everything from the past.
Yes.
Okay. And so the focus here is everything that this effort has produced. Nothing new.
That's right. They spent a lot of money on consultants.
And where we've actually the funniest part is, after I finally got going through it all, where they ended up with well over $100,000, and I think it's a lot more. And the town is actually refusing to produce what the legal fees are when there's been a Freedom of Information Act, or I'm going to challenge that for sure. So what the catalyst, or the what I believe makes the $100,000 or more, could be $500,000 for all I know. Well, but I know for sure it's well in excess of $100,000 they've right. wasted on this whole effort. And where they ended up is in the last two paragraphs of Loopster's decision he produced in 92.
Right.
And it says, we understand that the town's main interest in this matter is to preserve the view of the lake, and so on and so on. In this case, it appears that to us that these objectives may be achieved by the town without asserting claim on title to over the lakefront properties. And such unfounded assertions have only served to unnecessarily create acrimony across... How do you say acronymy?
Yeah, acrimony is good. Yeah.
Acrimony, sorry. that's my graded education coming through. So anyway, what he's saying is the efforts of the town to try to exert over the title, it just creates a big us against them, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
So and serves nobody's purpose, and it has borne out to serve nobody's purpose because they've never gotten anything resolved that way, and they're not getting it resolved this time that way either.
Yeah, I think in our larger podcast that we can address, there yeah. are solutions to this if both parties can agree to it. They can make it pretty simple, but you know,
yeah.
knowing the town and you know, sometimes they go with the more difficult avenues. But hopefully, in this case, they won't.
Yeah. That's the consultants. They go. Yeah. This council has been trained not to go against anything that consultants or the lawyers recommend. And that's the training of the staff members that we discussed. So anyway, that's just my opinions.
Well, and that's why it's a political decision. They can go one way or the other on it.
Well, that's why they call it politics, because the politicians are supposed to decide what happens in the town.
Exactly.
But in this case, they never do. They send it back. They don't get the answer they want. If there's any argument about it, rather than consider the taxpayers' arguments, they say, well, let's go back and study this some more.
Yes.
So then they come back on a new, and they eliminate the arguments one at a time. And so the taxpayers are not considered in the least. So that's my personal opinion, and I better watch it. I'm getting all excited here. So anyway, it says, once you get past the issue that there's no use in challenging title because it just creates a big mess and, yes, and nothing gets resolved. So it says, our clients would prefer to work together with the town to find a means by which these objectives could be achieved by legal means and on terms that are acceptable to all parties. Now that's 1992.
Yes.
And I got to tell you something else. Bob McLaughlin was in charge of the effort, or he was contributing to the effort and to the mindset at the time. And Bob McLaughlin, you know, his recommendations had always were not the issue of title. He always acknowledged, the town always acknowledged, the people are the only ones with the rights. So he's recommending here a bylaw that says that the town retain the right to cross over the property for maintenance on both the road and lakefront if they need it. So an easement, they would agree to quick claim the deed back to the sign a quick claim to the people. The people will not, they'll indemnify the town against any claims, so that takes care of the insurance issue. So anyway, there's a solution here.
Yeah.
And what I want to mention in this early portion that we're doing here now is that was done in 1992.
Yeah.
And the committee that's here now, Dave Soloski's on that committee, Daryl Blanchard's on the committee. I sat down and talked to Dave at length actually yesterday about this and a number of other issues. And all the people on the committee, they're so reasonable. They're trying to find a solution. So they went to the town and said, okay, look, if we don't challenge your ownership and we just agree to pay the whatever the surplus value is that the town normally disposes of surplus, they have a square per square foot value, then they and the town we won't oppose. And the town said, yeah, that would work. Okay, we can. So we have a solution. We're all done. And it's a solution that was proposed in 1992. So,
right.
So the hundred and something thousand they've spent, you know, that's a waste of the town. That's a town pursuing something they already knew they couldn't do.
Right.
So it's ridiculous. So then what happens is, so the committee agrees to this. The town actually agrees to it and passes a bylaw to pursue this avenue. And so it all they go away. So then when they come back, somebody raises the red herring of, well, if they sell. And this is where it becomes a red herring. And,
right.
And that is that if they sold a property that's worth $1 million for $2, then the taxpayers will say, hey, you're selling valuable property for that. That's irresponsible governance or whatever you want to call it. And you know, so then they send it away for appraisal. So nobody can argue with them because that's an argument you can't argue with. They're representing the taxpayers, right?
Right.
Yeah, well, yeah. I have a word for it, but I won't say it here. So what happens is they give a list of instructions for the appraisal. And herein lies the crutch. The appraisal that they're getting done has nothing to do with the property that's going on.
Right.
They say disregard any boathouses, anything on the land that they already purchased from the Ministry of Natural Resources, because they're actually the ones who do own it.
Yes.
And by deed. And that, again, is addressed by Bob McLaughlin. And that's in his other report in 2011. And I won't go into it now. But so the town doesn't even own the land. They couldn't own the land even if the resident didn't. The Ministry of Natural Resources owns it. And it's by their own mapping. There's actually mapping to establish it and a policy and a criteria. And the town documents even mention that all of those issues are governed by the Ministry of Natural Resources, so they shouldn't even be, you know, trying to impose their will in that regard. I got to move this because there's a big light in my face. Is that okay there?
Yep.
You can hear me?
I can hear you fine.
All right.
Yeah.
So anyway, you know what, Martin? I don't want to get into that any further, but I just wanted to address that the town's been extremely irresponsible here. The taxpayers and the residents have been very responsible trying to come to a proper solution, And the town council has been put in a position like they feel like they don't have a choice, and they've been put in that position by the staff members.
Yes.
Because so that's how we've got here. That's how we've wasted well over $100,000. So, and I've been offered the opportunity to participate.
Yes.
Through a land deal involving one of these properties, in which by my involvement, I can make a good living, make my standard living doing what I normally do with property and that kind of thing. And I have some expertise in the legal end of it. So what will be happening is I'm going to be challenging the appraisal period.
Right.
It's just not even in the realm. And I'm going to challenge, the whole concept of ownership of the town. I've got Loofster's legal opinion, and I've ordered the supporting documentation that he quotes so that I can do a requested judicial review of their entire process. And I'll be doing that in the days to come. Well, not the days, probably in about 2 3, I'm going to wait till the appraisals come in, and then I'm going to get the whole kettle of fish and take it into the judicial review.
Right.
That's my plan anyway. So am I insane? Like, am I wrong about all of this?
Well, it has to be done properly. And I think that
I happen to know how to do that.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
So. No, but I know, I mean, yeah. But I'm just saying, like, this whole issue has to be resolved so that everybody wins, not
right.
Not that somebody feels that they're losing.
No.
And the way it's a very convoluted process, and it's complex, but it is simple in another way.
It's totally simple. The resolutions are there.
Yeah.
The information that they have now has always been there.
Yeah.
The hundred and something thousand they spent now, total waste. That's another thing. Because the owners, the only reason the owners are even participating is because they don't want to go the legal route because it costs a lot of money.
And they're not going to be able to really resolve it. I mean,
they can never actually have ownership. They have to work it out. And now, so there's council, you know, taking advantage of the good-natured efforts of honest, hardworking, tax-paying people. They were making proposals based on the town's ex-lawyer's opinions. Like, they're not being unreasonable. And they cannot appraise those properties as if the boathouse wasn't there, as if the rights weren't against it, if they weren't, they are there. So the town, let's take a quick look at what they're appraising. What they're not selling is the use of the land, because the people already have it.
Right.
They're not selling the view of the lake, because they already have it. They're not selling ownership, because that's not possible. So, and then it can't be sold to anybody else. So if they don't buy it, they can't sell it at all.
Yeah.
So that's the appraisal criteria, but they didn't do that. They said, treat it like it's a normal piece of land. Get us an appraisal by square foot based on that. Well, that's, I already talked to Larry about this. That's done. That won't even be. So the ownership issue is dead. The Rusty Russell report issue is dead. The town lawyer is there now. It's actually his entire process is legitimate. He answers legitimate questions, and I believe he's answered questions in such a way that he's been instructed to do. Which, in other words, not do we have a legal obligation to collect all this money? Is there any way we can get all this money? As I think it was his instructions were. And so then he's come back with instructions that very softly say, well, you better, you know, get everything you can out of them, or you know, like, really nasty.
Right. Well, I think it's a difficult one, Tim, because, you know, knowing a lot of the properties in that area,
yeah,
because I've been around here so long, some of them, by the time you get some of the proposed road allowance or whatever it might be to the lake bottom, which the ministry owns, a lot of them have like a sliver of land that might only be like 6 inches or something. I don't know. And so how are you going to appraise a sliver of land 50 feet wide on your waterfront by 6 inches? I mean, it's just not possible to be fair to everybody on this.
And the value that they're talking about treating it like normal and there's no rights on it. You go to the boathouse, never mind the Ministry of Natural Resources owns a chunk of it. Just appraise it like a normal piece of land. And then charge the guy who's purchasing 1 foot of the frontage by that inflated value.
Yes.
Not based on what he's doing.
Yeah.
Or what his situation is. Every situation. So anyway, I will be legally challenging any. If the town takes one penny more than the, unless they just, the appraisals are done. They're not valid appraisals. They're valid on the criteria that they were given. The appraisers are good. The York appraisal, I know them. They're very good.
Yeah.
But, and they'll do it. But it's not contributory value.
No.
That's the normal contributory value, which we've done a number of times.
Yeah.
It's contributory value minus.
Right.
Minus that everybody has their rights on it. Minus that the ministry owns a big chunk of it. Minus that the improvements that have been done to it based on the ministry permits, that ownership is already the owner of the, they can't stop them from, they own that land.
Yes.
So they're appraising land they don't even own.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's how crazy it is.
Yeah.
And there's solutions, but somebody's being cheeky and pushing, getting, Frank Zibo said, why should we sell them valuable land?
Yeah.
Yeah, and I just disagree with him. I like Frank, he's a good guy, but I disagree with his characterization of that situation.
Yeah, well, I think, they could use it as another money grab if they want to, but I think that
I believe they can't.
If they don't, and they just resolve it in the cheapest way possible for everybody will have their rights considered and hopefully dealt with, and then everyone will know what they've got.
Yeah.
The problem is a lot of these, I bet you half of the lakefront owners really well, and it is confusing, so I bet half of them are misinformed about what they actually have and what they don't have.
They're in the same position as the town is. Uninformed after $100,000 back then, another $100,000 now. Everybody still knows what they always knew since day one. Everybody across the road has the rights. If anybody has a right to buy it, it has to be them. The town has no right over it. It's not there's no ownership possibly to be established, even the road allowance itself. Never mind where it was put.
Yeah.
And whether, and the land was, it was not taken by expropriation. So it doesn't even speak to, and this is, so I've talked to a number of lawyers about this. One particular that used to work at Thompson Rogers downtown. I used to send this stuff to Thompson Rogers. Anytime this come up, I did it with the world allowances. I bought Halliburton. Remember, I bought Halliburton up all the way through from Glenwood through to Irene. Yeah. Well, Bob McLaughlin, cool guy. Hey, he was adamant. He wasn't going to let me go through with that and blah, blah, blah. He was fighting for the town's tax dollars. He believed people shouldn't be making money off of property that the town owned. Like, he adamantly believed that.
Yes.
But it was already carved in stone. They decided to close the road. There's rights that are carved in the legislation, and I bought those rights, and he couldn't do anything about it, but he fought it, and I respected him because he did. And the one thing I liked about Bob, we were tooth and nail.
Yeah.
Go into council. Go at it, and get... I happened to win that day.
Yes.
Got back in the hall. Well, you won this one, Tim, and he went on about his business. Nothing personal. Like, he was really good like that. He fought tooth and nail for what he believed in. And when it was all over, whoever won, and you get on about your business and he was good that way. And
no, I liked him for that. He did. Yeah. I was involved in several things with him, and exactly what you just said. Yeah.
Yeah, him. And the reason all this went so smoothly back then, like, in other words, they come to the proper conclusion, we can't resolve this ownership-wise, so they just agreed to drop it because they didn't have any solutions proposed then.
Right.
With the exception of what Lufstra, and so they decided not to pursue that. But there was McLaughlin, Baskerville, Stan Armstrong, all people that were working just based on legislation, based on, what are we trying to achieve here? No personal, it was just straightforward. Now those people, like the council, those people answered the council always then. And they always looked for what does council want us to do?
Right.
That doesn't happen now. The staff comes to a report and tells council what, if you don't do this, you can be held liable because you've been recommended. So.
Yeah, it's they have to have it's a catch 22. Right. You have to have some direction from somebody because all these counselors can't know everything about everything, legally, but they certainly can have their opinion, which is that's why they're there.
Well, none of it addresses the Ministry of Natural Resources ownership or their input. And McLaughlin, right in his own report back then, says the Ministry of Natural Resources and their ownership rights, and because they don't want to encumber the town for now, they won't go against those properties. They won't insert their rights, but they still have them, and now the town's going to sell them to the people. And the ministry can come back after it, can go after it.
Yeah, so they might get...
might buy something that the ministry wants.
Yes.
Anyway, so I believe that gives us 24 minutes, which is a good introduction.
Sure.
What's your craziest experience you had trying to get something approved?
I'm not going there.
all right, well, I just had to ask. I got so many to choose from. I can't.
I know. I've over the years, you know, you always run into the town, of course, and but I find that in, for the most part, they're trying to do the right thing, and so am I. So you try to resolve everything.
Exactly right. Well, you know, it's funny. I remember one time Jerry was out in the hallway with Mike Basco, and they got so loud, kicking, you know, going toe to toe about something. And McLaughlin came on the hall and said, "Look, guys, take it outside," like that. You know, I mean, he didn't say stop arguing. He said take it outside because. You know, they recognize people had a right to argue, and then people had, and the good thing is, same thing like Harold, same way. I've argued with Harold till I'm blue in the face, and he listens to whatever your arguments are, and he addresses them to you. And sometimes he goes, "Oh, okay, I've never looked at that," and he'll change his mind if you make a case.
Yeah,
that doesn't happen anymore. It would happen with Harold. I've had a couple of things in recent years where I've asked Harold about it, and he's talked to staff about it, and they found a way that we could sort something out. So I mean. There's still cases, but for the most part, it's getting obscure, more obscure. You can't go to council anymore because people phone around before the meeting to find out what are you going to say if they ask that. So they get it all organized already to fend off anybody who doesn't want to do what they want to do. So there's no honest, open public input meetings anymore. Period.
Yeah.
Just there's the appearance of. Rebecca used to love those appearance of meetings. She would call a meeting, and you know everybody would show up. And they would you know have a coffee and go home. And then they would have the meeting, you know, okay, what are we going to do here, you know? So, anyway, I guess, so Tim Dermer, Georgina Speech, thanks, Martin. We're going to be on this issue more.
Oh, of course.
In the coming days.
Yeah.
Every time I talk to somebody about this issue, they go, oh, never mind this one. What about this other, you know? And so an Airbnb study, $100,000 to come back with recommendations that couldn't be used in the end. And again, Mike Smith, I think, did that one, but he did it based on the instructions he was given.
Yes, of course. And, that's how consultants work.
and then they ended up having to resolve it, and they couldn't pass it the way it was, and so they got it resolved, and even still, they're a mess. So anyway, the Airbnbs. So and then there's the boundary realignment for the ward boundaries.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, $100,000 paid a guy, and then he came back with four recommendations that they couldn't use, and in the end, they said, "Well, we have this one." That a couple of ex-counselors actually did the calculations, given that information, to go, he came back with their recommendations. Oh, good. So we got it all worked out, $100,000.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and there's a number of other issues that people phone me and tell me about this stuff, and I don't know why, because.
In our future one, we've got to have to talk about the Merck, I guess. Eh? I guess that's going to be
a
good one.
How dare you? Just when I think I was going to get out the back door.
No, I think we can close it off.
Okay. There's the link. The people that spent $500,000 on my case because I wanted to sit down in the beginning and work it out so I didn't have to go to the superior court, divisional court. And they just laughed at me because, well, we don't have to, you know, they thought they were just going to win hands down. It's ridiculous. The lawyer consulting, Winann Grant and Rebecca. And Winann was actually in charge of it, I believe, at that time. And Rebecca, she was kind of a victim in terms of she had so many hats she had to wear to take care of all the stuff. There's a lot of good stuff she did, and I don't want to get hogging on her. I was pretty hot to hogging on her because I was intensely into the issue at the time we went through it. But I did file a claim against her about it, actually, and I withdrew my claim. And the reason, because the town lawyer sent me a response letter to it.
Yes.
For her. So, and in the end, I just decided, you know what, we both went through hell, and I just decided to let go of it. So, but when Ann Grant was there, she was the one... together with Lufsa, who were, and I have it on good authority that it was very personal for Lufsa that he was after me.
Yeah.
And they bought into it, and well, I don't want to tell you the rest of it, but so there's $500,000 wasted right there. Not only that, $3 million in town directed adjustments and a couple hundred thousand they had to pay back because it wasn't handled properly, and it all could have been avoided if Winann and the town lawyer wanted to just sit down.
Yeah.
But they didn't. So that those are those costs, And then the new council's there, who's training them?
Right. Well, usually the staff.
Winann. She's the boss. She was training them, and so all of their instructions and this is what normally. And then consultants and staff use interesting language. Well, what normally is done under these circumstances, what we want you to do is, but they have the language that they guide you down the path to what they want you to do, you know. And they're not lying then because, you know, normally, but they don't instruct people how to make their own decisions.
Right.
They just
right.
tell them these are the decisions you have to make. And you ever sell real estate?
Well, of course.
You find the one that's the best deal in town, you find two similar, and you show that one last because that's the one they're going to buy, right?
Yeah.
Well, staff does the same thing.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're clear on that. All right. Anyway, you know, I don't want to ramble on, and it's too late for that, but I already have been. But so there's, we've got a number of other issues we can address in this series, wasted tax dollars, this particular one. Wasting away again in Georginaville.
Yeah, I think we can make a little tune.
I actually have the theme music coming for that. I'm going to take care of it.
Okay, well, Tim, thanks again, and I enjoyed this, and let's get a.
Yeah, me too. And so I'm gonna edit this really quickly because it's gonna go out exactly as we just did it.
Right.
And I want anybody who's listening to it to know this is preliminary. I apologize for babbling on so much, but I was literally up all night long reading every document on this subject that has been published since 1990. And since Rusty Russell did his original report on it, so I didn't feel comfortable moving ahead with the full podcast today because I want to be a little bit sharper when we address it.
Yeah.
And we'll be better prepared to be more concise, I guess.
Sure. Well, now that we've got that, we've read everything, and I think we can probably have hopefully a little bit more.
And we might get some feedback. We might get somebody, you know, sending us son of a bitch messages. talk about my town that way, you know.
Yeah.
Although I don't think we're going to get a lot of that. Okay, Martin. So we're good?
Yeah, we're good.
Okay, anything comes up, call me.
Bye.
Bye.
Wasting away again in Margarita. Searching for